So right there, you see ballot watchers. That's what they would call themselves. What they are is random people who have hidden their faces behind masks. Finally, they'll wear a mask, wearing tactical gear. And according to sheriffs that investigating it, they were armed as well. So they posted up in Mesa, Arizona, looking to intimidate people who were going to vote. Nicole Grigg shared some of this footage, and you can, if you want to see more of the video, it's available. But also provided some details about these people. They had, extra clips of ammunition, and they were in fact armed. Now, we're told that the Maricopa County Sheriff's Office responded. The men had apparently already left. Very brave. But deputies measured to make sure ballot watchers weren't too close. And I'm glad that they did that, because I know a lot of people seeing guys with guns trying to intimidate voters, you see that and you get concerned. Are they within 75 feet of the polling place? That's what I'm concerned about. No, not at all. I'm concerned about their presence at all. But apparently, they would have to be within that 75 feet for it to actually be a crime. That's what the deputies say. They measured it, and apparently it was fine. And so no need to worry, America. People are bringing guns to polling sites, but as long as they kind of keep their distance, it's not intimidation. By the way, you can see the actual part of the federal election laws right here, code 594, intimidation of voters, that in theory we could start to enforce that. I think that would be great. I don't know why 76 feet is okay, but 74 isn't. In any event, Dan, this is apparently happening in multiple areas of Arizona. There are also reports of intimidation in North Carolina. And as we get closer to actual election day, we can expect there's gonna be much more. This was for the early voting. Those guys were out there. Imagine what's gonna be happening on the actual election day.
And this is stuff that we on the left have been warning about for years. And it's important to note that the first bill that the past couple of Democratic houses have passed together is an election reform act to address some of these issues where you have secretaries of state in different states trying to do funny things because they're working with the Republican Party to make it so their voter fraud claims look like reality, which is funny doublespeak because the Republicans are the ones actually trying to commit voter fraud or voter suppression at the very least. And so this goes back to minor history lessons like the history of ballot box intimidation and voter intimidation that was specifically targeting marginalized communities and communities of color. You better believe these people who have guns out and they think that there's going to be some stealing of ballots or harvesting of ballots. They don't have great opinions of trans people. They don't have great opinions of Muslims or any other marginalized group. So this is absolutely dangerous. The fact that you don't have Republicans who are calling out anything about this also says something about the Republican Party, but this is just something that we are just starting to accept in society. The last thing, a history lesson I would give is that, you know, this is a pipe dream at this point based on how Democratic power is looking. But one thing that happened after the Civil War during Reconstruction was that states that were under, like, states that basically were in the South that tried to secede were put under special rules supervising how their voting and their election processes went because it was assumed that they would try to suppress the black vote.
Yep.
We should definitely do the same thing for all of these states that are trying to cry wolf for election fraud. That should be the punishment. If you say that, okay, we have election fraud here and you're a Republican Secretary of State and it's proven that it's negligible voter fraud, then you get you as a state are proven untrustworthy. You have your elections need to get supervised by another independent body because it's very clear that you are working to get one single party elected. You are the anti-democratic forces that you are crying about. Look in the damn mirror.
So you're basically advocating for a double or nothing election challenge system. Like if you challenge it and you're right, good, you found the fraud. But if not, now we're gonna go even harder towards letting people vote.
Absolutely.
I like it. Now, unfortunately, and by the way, thank you so much for pointing out that while these sorts of guys, and 90% of them are gonna be guys, are gonna be everywhere. Think about the intersection between this and racism. Like, what do you think is gonna happen in urban areas in red states, for instance? Like, do we just have to cross our fingers and hope no election workers get murdered this time around? No bombs go off, no No one drives a truck into a line of voters. Like, we just have to cross our fingers and hope that against all odds, none of that happens. When there's been two solid years of people whose entire personality is believing that Trump got robbed, preparing to do something to draw the eye and the notice of their great master.
Not only but they also believe it's a life or death thing, because they believe that Republicans don't win, Democrats are going to mutilate their kids. Like, that's actually the political discourse it's gotten to. It's ridiculous, it's sick. We talk against it on TYT and other networks on the left all the time, but because they've heightened it to a life or death situation, we now have to worry about life or death in poll numbers. Because unfortunately, the things you mentioned about trucks ramming through crowds or shootings, this is America. That stuff can totally happen. And I would be so devastated to see that on election day.
100%. Really fast, I just want to make sure that you understand some of the different ways that these intimidation cases work. Let's jump to a description of another one that Arizona Secretary of State Katie Hobbs, who's also running, of course, reported. I believe this was in Mesa as well.
If you read through the complaint, is he wrote that the people he was engaging with were, quote, filming and photographing my wife and I as we approached the drop box and accusing us of being a mule. More on that in a second. And that they took photographs of our license plate and of us and followed us out of the parking lot. That mule reference, Anderson, is referencing a conspiracy film that is often quoted by far right conspiracy websites and by some right-wing Republicans who are running for office in the state of Arizona. Anderson?
Yeah, so look, maybe they'll point a gun at you, but more likely they're gonna point a camera at you. They're going to be investigating you, they've been doing this for literally a year and a half now to election workers, trying to harass them on social media sites, tracking them down, tracking their license plate. And look, that's gonna intimidate the people that are actually there. But also, a lot of people might just make the calculation, is it really worth it? Like, I don't know, I'm a little bit tired, I didn't really want to vote anyway, and now maybe there's a dude with an AR-15 there. Like, the goal is to get 0.2% of the electorate to just decide that it's not worth it and to not show up, to drive people out of politics. That's one of the big goals, and it's going to be impossible to say if that worked. Anyone who decides not to show up, we will never know. But it would be very reasonable that some people might make that calculation at this point.
This is not wild speculation. There's the story of Ruby Freeman, who was actually intimidated by a Trump, by people who are part of the Trump campaign. She was a poll worker in Georgia in 2020, and like Associated Press covered this, a number of other outlets covered this, where Trump allies, essentially, were like from the Trump campaign, were threatening her with imprisonment and pressuring her and her family unless she testified and fell in line with the Trump line of thinking that there was voter fraud in Georgia. Okay, we know this is what they're doing. This is not even counting the Four Seasons landscaping thing that happened in Pennsylvania. Like, that attempt, it's not even counting the stuff that's happening in Arizona that we're talking about right now. We know this side is capable of this. So why are we acting like, well, gee, it can't happen again? When this is what happened last election, they're gonna learn from last election and try to come back harder. So we need to actually defend instead of, you know, doing too little too late. I worry we'd do a band-aid solution on all of these electoral threats when it is too little too late, because that's the American way.
Yeah, I mean, right now I would even take the band-aid. I don't even see a band-aid. I don't see the container of band-aids even being opened. I see basically nothing. Hopefully every individual little local election board is taking this seriously, because there doesn't appear to be any organized response to any of this. In the defense of those who should defend us, they've only had a year and a half to prepare. Why should they have anything, I guess? Check out the Damage Report podcast each day, wherever you get your podcasts, whether Pocket Casts or Stitcher or iTunes. You can join me as I give you the news and stories you want, with a range of co-hosts and interview guests jumping in on the fun each day. Again, that's the Damage Report, wherever you get your podcasts. And if you get them at iTunes, don't forget to rate and review. Sometimes I'll read them live on the show.